So today we have, I'm proud to introduce an alumnus of the college, Mr. Verdun Perry. We call him Vern Perry. He is a senior managing director at Blackstone and founding member and co-head of Strategic Partners Fund Solutions. Strategic Partners, with over $14 billion of assets under management, focuses on the purchase of private equity, limited partnership interests, and co-investments in leveraged buyouts, real estate, venture capital assets. Mr. Perry is one of the youngest African Americans to co-found a major investment firm. Mr. Perry received a Bachelor of Arts degree from Morehouse College in 1994, where he graduated magna cum laude and was elected Phi Beta Kappa, as well as a Master's of Business Administration from Harvard Business School, where he was the Robert Toigo Foundation Fellow. Mr. Perry, I've known for several years, is very well liked by his classmates. He's sort of I think, the quintessential example of being book smart and street smart. He has supported the college financially by assisting Morehouse men both professionally and personally, and he's just an overall good brother. So please join me in welcoming to the podium Mr. Vern Perry, class of 1994.
Thanks for that introduction, Bryant, or Dr. Marks, I guess you know him. It's pretty interesting for me to hear Bryant up here because I went to college with him. So if you ever want to hear some pretty funny stories about Dr. Marks, come see me, or see Jay Madison, who went to school with us, and you can ask him anything you want, and we'll share it. Thanks for being here, Jay. He's with his wife, Solana, as well. I would also like to thank our president, Dr. Wilson, and Provost Dr. Campbell for this opportunity and invite to speak to you today. To the trustees gathered, to faculty, staff, alumni, friends, and more importantly, to you, the students here at Morehouse College, I'd like to thank you for welcoming me home. And as a personal thank you, I appreciate you being here, because I know you don't necessarily have to be here, regardless of that text message thing we saw behind me. It's a lot different now. I'm surprised it's taken attendance like that, but hopefully I'll make it worth your while to spend some time here. I would also like to thank several people who made it possible for me to excel in Morehouse College and beyond Morehouse College. First, my parents, Kenneth and Edna Perry, my brother Shawnee, my sister Fran. I want to thank my daughter, Alana, who's 10 years old, for keeping me motivated, but more importantly, keeping me humble. It's pretty funny, when I told her that I was gonna be here speaking to you today, her response was, yeah, well, don't mess up. And she's pretty young, so I'm gonna give her a little bit more time to understand how special today truly is for me. I wanna also thank my finance professor, Dr. John Williams. Are there any business majors in here? Just raise your hand quickly. Do you know who Dr. John Williams is? Okay, well, we know him back then and to this very day as J-Dub. Matter of fact, class of 94 gave him that nickname. I don't know if that's true or not, but I'm going to go with that. And I'll tell you a story. The first time I actually got up the heart to call him J-Dub, I was walking, and everyone was like, just call him J-Dub. And everyone knew him as Dr. Williams or Professor Williams, and I was walking down the hallway. I said, I'm going to do it today. He looked up at me, and I said, what's up, J-Dub? And if you know him, he looked at me and said, hi, young man, and just kept walking right past me. So if you know him, that sounds just like him. I would also like to thank Dr. Vest, my marketing professor. Both Dr. Williams and Dr. Vest challenged us every day to be better, and I really appreciate that. I want to thank a couple people that helped me get through Morehouse. As you come through Morehouse, you're going to build lifelong friendships, and these are the people that you'll remember to the day you die. For me, those people are Jay Madison, Derek Leak, Jawanza Hughes, and Euclid Walker. I'll share with you a little bit later why, but those guys got me through some pretty dark days. And they're still with me today, through good or bad, no questions asked. And I appreciate that. And again, J-Mad is here today. And finally, I just want to say a special thanks to two of my best friends who are no longer with us, Amani Lamone and Ed Preston. Morehouse would not have been the same without you. And I'll do everything I can to keep your memory alive. You know, as I heard my bio read today, it feels a little weird. It just sounds strange that they're talking about me when they say that. You know, sometimes we get caught up in the next goal or that next deadline, and you don't fully appreciate everything that you've accomplished to date. And while I'm certainly proud of my accomplishments, what I'm more proud of are the things that you won't see in my bio, you won't see on my resume. It's those things, those little things that I had to do. It's the way I got through and responded during and after crisis, disappointment, tragedy, setbacks. In short, fellas, it was my will to fight. So, frankly, that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about today. I mean, I could talk about your bright futures, which you all have. You're going to go on and do great things. I want to talk about the things that can derail you from that. You're going to come up on situations and challenges that are terrible, frankly. I'm going to be real with you. I'll share a couple of those with you, but what I want you to know is personal resilience, discipline, and the will to fight are what you need to get through a crisis. But not just a crisis. You need that for everyday challenges, things that seem insignificant. I mean, the fact of the matter is the fight is on every day. And it's just as important to get your spirit up and fight those everyday challenges, like homework, like going to class, like coming to Crown Forum, like staying fit, like eating right. Things like that that happen every day, they go by because you don't recognize it as a fight. They are. Just like if you lost a family member, it's the same thing. And I'll just share a secret. As I go through this, I'll try and share things that I've learned over time that serve me well to this day. One of them is this. It is not what you do on your best day that determines your ultimate success, but rather what you do on your worst day. When you're at the bottom, when things are bad, and you think no one is there, what do? When it's the everyday challenge, homework, things that seem insignificant, what do? Fight or fold? That is the question. Now, having posed that question, I just want to share a little bit of information about my background and my journey, and hopefully you can relate to some of it, if not all of it. Hopefully you can take something away from the message today. I grew up in inner city Philadelphia, more specifically West Philadelphia, more specifically Overbrook. And if you're from Philly, you would probably recognize it as Hilltop. Okay, appreciate that. Now, like many of you in the audience, I grew up in a neighborhood, working class neighborhood, that I considered rough at times. I would actually say that's probably an understatement. It was probably rough most of the time. It's funny, my father taught me how to box when I was 6 years old. And I remember saying to him, why are you waking me up at 8 a.m. on a Saturday? I don't want to do that. I want to watch cartoons. And he looked my brother and I in the face and said simply, you're going to have to fight. And I didn't realize how truthful that was. And I'm here in a suit today and a tie, but I'll tell you, I used those skills many times growing up in Hilltop. Having said that, we had good neighbors, people that kept us out of trouble. You know, one of my best friends, Melvin Floyd, his father was Officer Melvin Floyd. His son's an officer as well. At the worst moments, I'm talking about you think you might not make it to the next day. Somehow his father always appeared. So when they say it takes a village, it's absolutely true. My parents worked hard to keep me and my siblings on track, keep us out of trouble. They always stressed the value of education from a very young age. And they often talked about me going to college. But during my sophomore year in high school, it finally hit me. They're not going to be able to pay for it. So almost instinctively, I mean instantly, I went and got a job at a fast food restaurant. And I became obsessively focused on my studies, doing homework. So much so that my mom would ask, am I okay? I would go to my room. I didn't tell them, hey, you can't pay for it, so I'm going to have to do it somehow. Because the fact of the matter is, for me, I knew if I was going to go to college, I had to get a scholarship. One of the proudest moments of my life was handing my parents an acceptance letter for Morehouse College with a 4-year scholarship. My mother hugged me and sort of yelled for joy. And for a second, I thought my dad was going to cry. And I don't know if he was happier that I had gotten into my top choice college and with a scholarship, or the fact that he didn't have to come up with the money to pay for it. It was one of those two, I'm telling you. So as I go through that, I got that scholarship. I was really excited about going to Morehouse. You know, aunts were like, my nephew's going to be a Morehouse man. My parents, my son's going to be a Morehouse man. My brother, my little brother's going to be a Morehouse man. And all was well. My future was bright. I had everything to look forward to. And then 3 weeks before I went off to orientation down here at Morehouse for your first year, one of my good childhood friends was killed on a basketball court. He was shot 14 times over an argument about who had next on the basketball court. I was standing about 3 blocks away, and I heard the gunshots. Now, like some of you, gunshots aren't new to me growing up. Heard them all the time. But when you hear that many, in your gut, you know someone did not make it. And I instantly ran to the playground because I said, my brother's over there. And as I got closer, I saw crowds and crowds. When I got there, it was just a pool of blood. Just mad. I've never seen anything like it. And someone said, your brother and Shep picked him up and took him in a private car to the hospital. He was dead before they picked him up, but they still tried. That was my send-off to Morehouse College. That was my goodbye party. I hardly had time to process that loss when I arrived here on campus for my first day of orientation. I sat back there in this room, like many of you are sitting today, and someone up here on stage said, and I don't know if they still do this, look to your right, look to your left. One of you won't be here at graduation. Do they still do that? Okay. Well, when he said that, I looked up and said, I'm going to be here. I'm going to graduate. Not just graduate, I'm going to excel. And so with that, it started. And I left orientation. And from the time I got here to Thurman, I don't know what they call Thurman Hall now. It's right next to Du Bois. Okay. Thurman Hall, 208. From the walk from here to there, my father said to me 10 times, you know you need a 3.0 to keep that scholarship. I got it. I heard him. It was in the scholarship letter. So classes started. And for me, I did well in high school. I played sports. I'm a pretty smart guy, and so I think I had everything figured out. Do you know what I got on my first test? Not too many people know this. J-Mad doesn't know this. Bryant doesn't know this. You know what I got on my first test? A 33. And I don't mean a 33 out of 35. I don't mean 33 out of 40. I mean 33 out of 100. It was an algebra test. And I'm thinking to myself, wow, this isn't good. I literally, that night, I remember I asked my girlfriend, I said, do you think I should drop this class? And she just looked at me and said, When you get that sound and that, you know you're in trouble. So the next class, I went back, and after class, I went up to the teacher and said, I really need to drop your class. I'm on a scholarship, and I can't afford to lose it. And he said, yeah, well, I know you got a 33, and you should know that was the easiest test. They actually get harder from here. And I said, yeah, let me. Can you sign this right now, actually? Sign this drops up right now. And he said to me, he asked me a question. He said, well, let me ask you a question. Did you study? And I said, of course I studied. And he said, well, when did you study and how long did you study? And I said, well, I studied the night before the test for 5 hours. And he kind of chuckled at me. I said, well, why did you do that? If you would have studied 30 minutes per night, 2 weeks leading up to the test, you would have scored a lot better. I'll make a deal with you. And this is, he gave me some of the best advice ever. Study 30 minutes a night. Don't cram 30 minutes a night leading up to the test. And he said, you have plenty of time to drop the class. So here's the deal. If you score poorly on this next test, which is in 2 weeks, I'll happily sign your drop slip. So I went back, and I was embarrassed because I had been here for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 2.5, and I'm talking about dropping a class. What I was more embarrassed about is this, and I'm sharing with you, and no one has ever heard this. My hand was trembling when I took that test. My hand was literally shaking from fear. The pressure for me to succeed was so intense that I was scared to fail. I was so scared that it psyched me out. I couldn't even understand what I was reading. Because in my head was, either you stay and make it or you go home and die. That's my trade-off. That'll mess with you a little bit. But I said, I'm gonna give this a shot. So I studied 30 minutes a night, sometimes an hour. And one of the things I started realizing really quickly, I started understanding material better, more completely. And if there's anything I didn't understand when I studied at night, I just asked about it in class. You can't ask about it if you cram. You can't ask about it during the test. And so I took that test, that next test, and the night before, I studied for about an hour, I got a 95. I finished Morehouse College my first year with a 3.7 grade point average. I came home for the summer, and I showed my report card out of 3.7. My mom hugged me and said, "I'm not surprised, son." My dad said, "I'm relieved." I know you were. The fact of the matter is, those little things, that studying 30 minutes a night, being responsible, being disciplined, that's what wins the day. It's those small things that you don't think are significant. I mean, think about it. Think about someone having a heart attack. Now they got to fight. It's significant. But if they had worked out and changed their diet, they could have avoided that altogether. You have that opportunity. Don't wait till crisis. Some things you can't control. Guaranteed, it's going to come to you. But there are a lot of things you can control. When you procrastinate, when you make excuses, I'm here to tell you, it has long-term significant implications for you and your family. So I look out, and I saw a couple guys walk out. That's cool, because I'm good. I'll be good, and I pray that they're good too. But it's those little things that you miss, those little moments that you let go by when you should have just taken advantage of it. You understand what I'm saying? Take advantage of that. You're young. I still feel like I'm young, but you're really young. Take advantage of those moments. The summer after my freshman year, I went home, worked for the city of Philadelphia. Summer was great. Everything was good. I felt like I was smart. I'm in Morehouse going into my sophomore year. It was pretty uneventful, but it was fun. And I remember calling my best friend on July 3rd, Amani Lamone, and saying, "Why don't you come up for the Greek picnic?" Which was July 11th, which is my birthday. And he said, "Done, I'm up there." And my girlfriend was in town, and my brother and friends would be there. We're just gonna hang out and have a good time. And on the evening of July 5th, 1991, I received a phone call from a friend who was down here for the summer at Morehouse taking summer classes. And he called to tell me that Amani was killed in a car accident on the early morning hours of July 4th. Now, keep in mind, I'm 18. This is my best friend, who, by the way, turned 17 during freshman year. I'm the youngest of three, so he was my little brother. And J. Matt, you remember him. Everyone loved him, but he was small. He was smaller than everyone else. So me, Ed Preston, Dave Warrington, several other guys, if he ever had a problem, we handled that quickly. And it was very rarely that he had a problem, but that was my brother. So when he died, I, for years, many years, took responsibility. I felt that I let him down. I felt like if I was driving, he'd be alive. If I told him to come that week, he would still be alive. If I had gone down there July 4th and hung out with him instead of letting him hang out with these other dudes, he'd be alive. That's tough. It gets tougher. I came back here for sophomore year, and we were such good friends. My girlfriend was close with his girlfriend. We requested that we be roommates sophomore year. Guess what? When I got back, we were. He was assigned to my room. So for 3 weeks, I went to bed every night with that bed empty as a stark reminder that my best friend had died. He was gone. Now, it's interesting, when my parents dropped me off sophomore year, I remember my mother just tears, like just on the verge, because she didn't want me to come back. She did not want me here. And I remember I walked up to her, and at that point in time, I was obviously I was shook. I had been shaken by this, confidence, everything. And I said to my mother, "It's gonna be okay. I need to be here. It's the right thing for me long term." And she just nodded. One of the hardest things I've ever done. And she silently, when my parents left, I could just see her. I still remember that day because she knew I had to go back into a room that was assigned to my best friend that was dead. That'll rock you, guaranteed. And so I tried. I remember that semester, that was the lowest score I'd ever gotten in terms of my GPA. But I said, I gotta keep trying. And I remember one day, I went up the hallway to J. Med, right here. I went to his room, And I didn't want anything. I just wanted to be around somebody. So I went in there and I said, do you have any snacks? And I remember his mom was always sending them care packages. We'd always call him mama's boy. Got a care package like every 2 weeks, man. I mean, I don't get that. But he had a care package. And I said, do you have snacks? He said, yeah, the care package is right there. Grab whatever you want. And I said, well, just tell me what you don't want, and I'll take that. And he said, whatever I want, you can have. Go in there and grab it. And what he taught me was, sharing isn't giving someone something you don't want. Sharing is giving someone something that you place value on, that you also want. And I remembered that. And I know what you were trying to do. And I'll never forget that. He knew I was struggling. And so he was trying to say, it's okay. It's family here. And I remember that night, something inside of me started to well up. It wasn't anger. I don't know what. You know the feeling when you've been mistreated or you're in a situation where you're just like, I'm not dealing with this anymore. It's unacceptable. I'm not having it. That energy, I call it natural pride. It's not pride driven by external factors like clothes or cars or money. It's internal. It's your inherent. You should be proud because you deserve the best. You deserve better. And because I know I had at least one person on my side, I said, I'm going to fight. And I went back. And I went through my whole college years like that. See, what you'll find is no matter what you go through, someone's going to come into your life and they're going to help you fight. Try and recognize it. Sometimes it's very subtle. They're going to give you that energy to make it to that next day or that next year. It's pretty funny talking about people helping fight. Has anyone ever heard of SEO, Sponsors for Educational Opportunity? So my junior year, I interviewed for SEO. I got an interview. It's a competitive program that puts minority students on Wall Street. It's one of the hardest internship programs to get in on a planet. I got an interview. It was right here, next door, in Gloucester. And that was the good news. The bad news is I had no suit. Literally, I went there to the interview with a borrowed suit. I borrowed a suit between Ed Preston and Derek Leak, the suit, the shirt, the tie, the watch, the belt, the shoes. The only thing that was mine was my socks and my underclothes. And I remember walking from Whitehall over here for the interview. And I remember someone in the yard, somebody that I knew, they didn't mean it in the hospital, they said, whose suit are you wearing? You look like a clown. And I remember thinking, you're right. You're right, but I'm hungry. The fact that I was hungry outweighed the fact that I looked like a clown. It looked like I was in my big brother's suit. It looked bad. But I interviewed for that internship, and I got that internship. Not only did I get that internship, I'm now on the board of SEO. And by the way, fellas, I always keep a special eye out for men and women in an ill-fitting suit that are just hungry. You don't have to come in there all dappered up. Just be hungry. And I don't mean hungry for money. I'm talking about hungry for something better, hungry to achieve, hungry to win. I can sense it in you now. If I'm in a room with you for 2 minutes, I know you already. It's tangible. As you sit in the audience and you think about your situations, whether they're monetary, whatever, family situations, trouble, don't be discouraged. Without a doubt, it'll be greater later. Take time. You'll get there. Just trust me on that. And as I think back, although I kind of brush it off, I can't remember who said, that suit looks crazy. I remember Bryant Marks, though. I remember Jay Mann. I don't remember who said that. That'll tell you everything you need to know. And by the way, my suit, tie, and shoes, they look pretty good now. Now, one thing I want you to do as you go out there, I want you to be impatient enough to want success now, determined enough to work for it every single day, and then patient enough to give it time to happen. I get it. I was in your shoes. I mean, I got $25 sent to me per month from home, and I was on a full scholarship. We call it leaking. I was leaking. I had nothing. So I was literally, I was hungry, literally and figuratively. It's okay to be hungry. It gets better. You got to keep fighting. Now, I talked a little bit about people helping you along the way. I'm just going to share one more story just to drive it home and just to make a point. In 2010, from late October through mid-December, I took time off from work. My sister was in the final stages of her battle against cancer. And I remember going into my founder's office and saying, "My sister's dying, man. I got to go." You know what his response was? "Go. Be with your family. We will take care of the things here. Come back when you're ready." Now, I had just gotten promoted to managing director that year. So in terms of timing, not ideal for me to be taking that time off. Yeah, I called in. I did some meetings from the road. But the fact of the matter is I needed to be home with my sister. Our founder, by the way, looks nothing like us. He's of German-Dutch origin, about 6'4", grew up on a dairy farm in upstate New York. But you know what? He gave me a shot. Not just from the beginning. He protected me, sponsored me, mentored me, gave me responsibilities, helped me grow. I now co-run the business with him. Not too many people in your life will do that. The point I'm making is there are a lot of people out there that are going to help you. They don't all look like you. By the way, there's a lot of people out there that look like you that will not help you. I hear you. Stay hungry. On December 6, 2010, at 2:33, my sister passed away. But you know what's great? I was there. As sad as it was also beautiful because the family was around. I was whispering words of encouragement to her. I saw her breathe her last breath as I held her hand. And unless you've seen that, I can't fully describe it to you. But I can tell you this, to this very day, there's no place on the planet I would rather have been than with my sister. I'm proud of that more than anything on my resume and my bio, because family comes first. Yeah, jobs are important. Money's important. Careers are important. Nothing's more important than your family. There's certain times in a person's life where you absolutely have to be present for them. Do not miss that chance. Do not leave them hanging. Be there. I share these experiences with you not so you feel sorry for me. It's not about that. I'm sharing things with you I've never shared with anyone. I got a 33 on my first test. I don't want people to know that. This is family, though. I'm letting you know. I graduated with a 375 Beta Kappa, but I started off with a 33. So if you understand what I'm saying, you can start off slow and finish strong. If you don't have money in your pocket, don't worry about it. You can get it. But the only difference between where you sit right now and where you want to be is your ability and will to fight. Not just the big battles, the small ones, the ones that are hidden as everyday responsibilities. They're subtle. They're so subtle you miss them. And those are the things you really need. You think Tiger Woods won that first Masters because of what he did that day? Nope. It's because of what he did all the years leading up to that, putting in the dark, going to the driving range for hours on end. Think about that. I could have shared many more experiences with you, to be honest with you. Frankly, I don't have the time. And some of those are much tougher than the ones I shared with you. Bryant knows some of them. Jay Mad knows some of them. Everyone I named earlier, they know all of them. That's just a subset to give you, to make some points for you. So when bad things happen to you, I want you to use it as fire to motivate you. Let it feed that will to fight. Because those things will happen. But I can tell you all the things I've been through, I'm still here. I'm still standing here. And I'm stronger than I've ever been. I mean, I've fought so much, I've learned to embrace it. I've almost learned to enjoy it. If you see someone struggling, by the way, don't wait for them to ask for help. Go offer your help. A lot of people don't want to ask for help, but they're struggling. You know that. J-Mad knew I was struggling. He didn't say, want to talk about what's wrong? He just did what he knew he had to do. That means more to me than anything. So if you see someone struggling, just go to them and say, what can I do? Or here, can I help you study? And I just want you to know this. When it comes your turn to fight, know that you do not have to fight alone. I may not know you, but I know you. I'll help you if I can. There are a lot of people in this room that'll help you if they can. And there's a lot more people not in this room that'll help you. So remember, you do not have to fight alone. The fact of the matter, fellas, you have a bright future. You're going to go on to do great things in politics, medicine, law, business, theology. You're going to do great things, make your family proud. But bad things will happen. Really bad things. Don't internalize them. Deal with it head on and let it go. But bad things will happen. And I wish I could be there with you when someone says, you know, you're not getting this job, or you got a D, or somebody looks down on you because you went to Morehouse College. I don't know why they would do that, but if they did, I wish I was there. I wish I could be with you when you had to fight. Some of you already know how to fight. When it's all over, you will all know how to fight. But I wish I could be there for you, but I can't. It's not realistic. Your parents can't be there for you for every fight, every challenge. Neither can your professors. So in the meantime, you know what I want you to do? When you experience disappointment, fight. When someone looks down on you because of your financial situation, fight. When you lose your confidence, fight. When you have a family member incarcerated, fight. When you lose a family member to a murder or anything like that, fight. If you have a family member diagnosed with cancer, fight. If you're diagnosed with cancer, fight. If you have a loved one overseas in the military, fight. And when they get home, help them fight. Oftentimes, they have to fight again when they get back here. And their survival is no less dependent on this fight than it was on the one overseas. If you think you're alone, know that you're not alone. Fight! In closing, I'm going to leave a saying that I came up with years ago. And I recite it to myself quietly before I leave my house. And it goes like this. They think I'm going to lose, but I know I'm going to win. Because my body will give out before I give in. So, fight or fold? That is the question. I pray that you fight.